Our guest speaker today has done exactly this. Josie Janz-Dawson was born on Thursday Island in the Torres Strait. Her family moved when she was four to Derby in northwest Kimberley. She came to PLC in 2003 on an academic scholarship, where she was a boarder for 3 years and graduated in 2005. Josie has represented Australia in netball and received a scholarship to the AIS. In 2009, Josie joined the Wirreconda Foundation as the Dare to Dream Girls program coordinator, where she works to inspire Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander girls to lead healthy lifestyles and build pride in their culture and identity. But what is most inspiring about Josie is her long-held commitment to serving and leading her people from surviving to thriving.
Hello everyone. I was actually very nervous thinking about addressing my old school, and obviously there's a lot of familiar faces around here and teachers, and one of the first things that my year group asked me when I saw a couple of them is that they asked if I get to call Miss Blackwood Beth, and I think I can, so that's something that you guys all get to look forward to when you finish school. like what was said, I came to PLC and I suppose I don't have a lot of time, so I can't tell you all a lot about my journey, but I hope to leave with you guys some inspiring things that can actually make you think about your place in the community and actually how you can give back. Growing up in a small town, you don't really know much more than the roundabout and the stop sign that's in your community. Coming to PLC, it was a complete culture shock. I went from a school that, in most of my school photos, I didn't have shoes on, to obviously coming to PLC, you had to shine your shoes, wear your stockings, your ribbon in your hair, the blue, the navy, the white, I don't know what it is these days, people have a bit of a mixture going on. But it was a complete culture shock to come to a school where a lot was expected of you. I think in our town, our schools are basically somewhere that parents drop their kids off, and it was more of a babysitting sort of regime and routine. So coming to PLC, a lot of people expect a lot of you, and they hope that you achieve high things. And when you leave school, people go, oh, you went to PLC, like, what was that like? Like, that must have been amazing. And it's funny to pick that out in the community. People have different visions of what education can be. And people thinking that coming to PLC is that it's a totally different experience. Which it was for me, a little girl coming from the country. But growing up and then being able to get to a point where you understand that your community and your people are really suffering, I went through quite naive. I didn't see a lot of the issues because I just thought basically what a lot of families think is that it's very normal for our young people to have a life expectancy that's way below non-Indigenous people, or that chronic health issues are really common for our people, that no one actually wants to fight these issues. I always work with young people now, and a lot of the young kids actually also say that they think, drinking and drugs is the Aboriginal way, and it's the way of our people because it's what they see. And being able to have to work in a space where you have to change that mindset is really hard. At the foundation, we've got three main areas we focus on, so health outcomes for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, the education outcomes and employment. And it was only 2 days ago that I went out to a school and I visited a couple of kids. I heard their story, I heard a little bit about their background, and I got in the car and drove to work. And I was what Noongar people I was feeling really winyan. Which is like when your heart feels really sorry for people. And I went into my office and I spoke to other staff members and I was saying, I don't know how we're going to help these people. I sit in the office and I write concepts and I try and inspire myself to go, what's the one thing I can fix that can actually have a chain reaction on all our people? And for me, the main point is having pride in our identity. So even for you guys, when if you're working with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, you have to have a real core strength in your identity, and that just means you know where you come from, you know where you're going in life, and that's what will give you a good spirit wherever you travel around Australia. And it's important for Aboriginal people that we keep building our pride. So the girls being able to practice culture, language, going out to country, hearing stories from people like Ronnie Forrest, and other people around the community who are well-respected elders, to actually share and give back what that culture is. Because we grew up with a verbal culture. We can't pick up a book and read our history and then go, oh, if your grandparents passed away, here's your family tree. It's really hard for us because that history is not there. And for you guys, I think if you really want to give back and create change in a way of service, building mutual respect. So a lot of our young people that we work with, we try and break down the idea of the hierarchy. So you share your story, they'll share their story back with you. And it's based on that even level playing ground that we go, I hear you and I see you and I respect you. And it goes back the other way. So that's first things first in terms of building relationships and connections. The other one is also being able to make a positive cultural contribution. So for you guys, I don't mean go and learn some Noongar dance and start dancing out there. It's more about if there are things happening, NAIDOC Week, Indigenous Round, Reconciliation Week, these are all special events in our calendar, but really it's a very tokenistic effort in terms of being able to celebrate Aboriginal culture. We're on Noongar land right here, and it's important that we celebrate every day that this land, Australia, was actually owned well beyond any of us actually came and planted our feet here. So it's really important that Aboriginal culture is celebrated every single day. And that's what brings pride and happiness to us as well. And lastly, it's being a champion and a leader. And for us, leadership isn't about the one person goes ahead and tries to get everybody to follow. I think all of us have had that at some stage. If you've got a little brother or sister, my little sister followed every little thing I did. If I ran around the oval, she followed me. If I wore my hair in a certain way, she copied me. So for you guys, you're already leaders in your own right. You don't have to finish year 12 and decide what you want to do with your career to go, now I'm going to turn around and lead these young people and change my community. It's really important that you understand exactly what you're giving back to and how far it's going. So again, mutual relationships, mutual connections, mutual respect, making a positive cultural contribution, being actually actively involved in your community, and being a great leader. So I hope you take something away from this, and thanks for listening.